So some of these that I've already talked about, you know, some aspects of them before, I'm just going to, you know, kind of go over them fairly quickly. How can we let go of mental states like resentment and forgive? How can we let go of mental states like resentment and forgive? By practice. Eightfold Path. And also there's one thing to remember. The golden rule, right? You all know that. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. So if you don't want people to resent you, then you shouldn't resent other people. And if you would like people to forgive you, then you should forgive other people. You know, and that golden rule sums up the whole law of karma, actually. Because no one would have purposely do anything to cause themselves to suffer. What is the best way to get over a fear or aversion? The bees outside bring fear, and I have a strong aversion to their buzzing noise. Now, if somebody, you know, is allergic to bees, I mean really allergic, and has a, you know, life or death, has to take a, you know, one of these things, or they'll die, then I would admit to them that fear is okay. But other people who just, I don't like the sting. Or, you know, something, you know, it's just a sting, you're not going to, you know, have a, you know, an attack, hopefully not, or, you know, something worse. Then, you know, be mindful around bees. If you move slowly and mindfully, generally they probably won't attack you. They attack you when you suddenly intrude on their place or you do some sudden movement. I've experimented with myself. And, you know, you move very mindfully and slowly and maybe even send some metta. And, you know, maybe once in some strange while, maybe one would attack you. But maybe you have some negative thought in your mind. I don't know. But anyway, actually any fear or aversion, at least, let's say 90% of them, which are usually just mental projections, put yourself in that position and face it and realize it's, you know, 90% just your mental projection. Sure, it may be caused because of some past experience, some past life experience even, like people that are afraid of heights or they're, you know, afraid of, you know, have phobias. Some of that could be a carryover from past lives or even your experience with certain people also. But you know, the best way is to put yourself in that position and just use it as a meditation practice to know that, you know, that most of that fear is unfounded. Just like I overcame my aversion to avocados, right? Put myself in that position and made myself eat them. But I was applying the Dhamma, so that helps as you're putting that position, reflecting. This fear is an illusion, these things, you know. everyone else in the world does these things, why am I afraid of these? Because otherwise, you know, then you'll continue to be have that kind of fear and aversion and limit yourself to, you know, free living. Oh, it says, I practice metta to the bees, but the fear of being stung is still there. They were painfully stung in the past, so that brings that fear. But anyway, use that noting, like it's just hearing. And then perception. You hear a sound, the mind remembers, oh, this sound belongs to, you know, a bee. That bee is a perception, and your mind is recreating that perception again, and then dragging in the past type of memories of it and the fear from the past. But basically, you're living in the past. You're no longer in the present moment. So, you know, this is the way we have to reflect on these things and to apply them in order to hopefully, you know, transform our sankharas and so on. But most people, they just keep reinforcing the fears and reinforcing the fears. Where I live, the best teacher to practice with is in the Shambhala lineage. Bhavana is a long drive. As long as it's not confusing to me, is it okay to practice with more than one tradition? Look, if you go to other centers, as long as they're practicing some form of, you know, meditation that conforms with, you know, overcoming hindrance, you know, conforms to basically, you know, sila, samadhi, and panya, then, you know, if it's a slightly different meditation practice, but, you know, if you're comfortable with that and you get some benefit, you can be okay. But Shambhala in the past, that was known for people not having very good sila. And even people drinking there and so on, and even getting in other kind of mischiefs. So, you know, you have to be, I don't know what they're doing now, this was like 30, 35 years ago when there's, but, so, therefore, you know, just, but as long as you know, you get benefit from that, but, you know, if they're teaching you something like, oh, drinking's okay, you know, you know, if you're strong, drink won't bother you, or free sex won't bother you, or, you know, there are some ideas like that out there. So, you know, I'd be a little careful with this kind of ideas if, you know, if they're teaching that sort of thing. But again, it's up to you. But if you look around, you might find, you know, like a Vipassana group, mindfulness group, Theravada group. I don't know where you live, but you know, there are some connected with, you know, IMCW and some other places like that too, out in the Maryland, D.C., Virginia area. There's quite a number of these kind of Theravada mindfulness Vipassana groups. I want to ask if there's a proper order of practicing Buddhist meditation. Do we need to practice Anapanasati first, then Vipassana? What is the relationship between Vipassana and excess concentration? Yeah, if you follow the suttas and so on, actually the proper order is to, you know, try to follow sila first, which is a kind of meditation, which involves mindfulness. And then it depends. There's different forms of anapanasati. But yes, generally to practice vipassana, actually there's three words or stages that I normally like to explain. First is mindfulness. First, to be mindful, you know, kind of slow down your activities, be mindful of the body, mindfulness of your mind, you know, just what we call general mindfulness. And as you practice mindfulness, you get more relaxed. And then, of course, there's different methods. There's a method of what is called anapanasati vipassana, in which you use the rise and fall of the breathing, or just the way that I've been teaching, actually. So we use the breathing as a, you know, to try to get an anchor and to develop some sense of, you know, relaxation and some sense of, you know, some tranquility, to weaken the momentum of the neurotic thoughts, to, you know, try to overcome the grosser hindrances, right? So using the breathing like that, whether you want to follow the breathing and focus at the tip of the nose until you get some, you know, white light nimitta or something, or you could also practice metta as a form of tranquilizing your mind, or you can, just basically, you know, do the, you know, focusing on the rising and falling of the breathing and gradually noting whatever predominantly comes into your mind. So there's different ways of doing it, and you can experiment with different ways. But generally, those are the kind of popular general methods that most people use. But so mindfulness comes first. By practicing mindful, you get more concentrated. And as I said, I think on the first or second day, I have my own little pet formula that mindfulness plus concentration equals vipassana. So vipassana, real vipassana, is a more high-octane type of awareness. The awareness is supported by tranquility and allows you to begin clearly seeing the arising and vanishing of, you know, sensations and sounds, and tuning into that flow of impermanence without the distraction of the hindrances or, you know, drowsiness. So yes, the tranquility is necessary, but I wouldn't say it's you have to go all to the point of getting absorbed in jhanas to practice that. But some people prefer to, and it's okay. If you can practice concentration and attain jhanas, that's well and fine, because as I mentioned, the stronger concentration you have, then when you do go on to vipassana, developing wisdom should be very fast. But people who don't have a real strong concentration, it may take them longer to develop that. And so those are the two different methods. Actually, in meditation, to different types of people, some people practice a concentration or tranquility first, attaining access concentration, maybe the first jhana or even up to the fourth jhana if they're able to. But without getting stuck in that, they use it to develop insight. And you can develop insight on the basis of the jhanas also, and even going into the formless jhanas. There's methods explained in the Visuddhimagga and others about how to develop wisdom based on attaining jhanas. But for others who may not find that easy, then cultivating mindfulness first to the point of momentary concentration, and then developing vipassana through that will lead to the deeper concentration, will lead to jhana too. And it's called vipassana jhana. Because when you can tune in to the rising and falling from moment to moment, the hindrances get banished and the mind becomes one-pointedly focused in the present moment, and that's equivalent to the jhanic state. But it's called vipassana jhana, because you attain the jhana through the practice of mindfulness and vipassana, rather than practicing a jhana first and then practicing vipassana based on that. They're both valid methods. They both work, but it's a matter of temperament. And people with past experience, maybe at concentrating, it's for them it's a little fairly easy. And it's well and good. But I think the vast majority of people might find, especially lay people living busy lives, to develop and to maintain a state of being able to easily at any time attain jhanas and so on, is not very easy. And also, in my own view, especially for lay people, the practice of mindfulness and, you know, general mindfulness and, you know, being aware of your thoughts and so on is important for the daily living, because that's where you have to be mindful. I'm going to talk actually more about that in tomorrow's closing talk about how to practice mindfulness in daily life. But anyway... So, again, there's a lot of, you know, questions about mental states and, you know, getting caught into various types of mental states, where it's pride or righteousness or anger or so many other types of mental states, and, you know, people asking how can they, you know, find a way to terminate it. And, you know, I keep saying, you know, I can't say it enough, and, you know, I don't know any other way except cultivating mindfulness, concentration, and wisdom. And developing the mindfulness to detect those thoughts when they're just beginning to arise. You yourself should get, if they come a lot, then you should be aware, you should know their symptoms and what kind of triggers there are, and guard yourself on them. And when you see the potential for something like that, then, you know, you have to put yourself on guard, so to speak, and be aware that it's arising, and then apply some antidote. The antidotes are contemplating that this mental state, whatever it is conditioned. It's conditioned by society. It's conditioned by the ego. And it's basically, it's just a habit. And you have to contemplate that over and over and over again until it sinks in. And to apply the antidotes, the opposite kind of qualities of those mental states. You know, people want a magic potion, you know, it seems, you know. They want something else, you know. But it's all there in the teachings of the Buddha. How can we find out about your upcoming retreats, teaching? I have a blog, which has my schedule, travel and teaching schedule on it. I'll put that blog address up on the bulletin board maybe by tomorrow. What is the meaning of yoga vachara? Yoga vachara is a word that means it was an epithet for forest-dwelling monks who were hell-bent on getting nibbana. That means who were constantly at meditation. It's a combination of two words, yoga and avachara. And avachara means to continually hit and strike at yoga. So it was a kind of a moniker for forest-dwelling monks, yoga vacharas. That was back in the time. And it's mentioned in the Buddhist text, that name. Although in my case, it's interesting. I got my Buddhist name, Rahula, from my yoga teacher. And I got the name Yoga Vachara from my Buddhist monk preceptor in Sri Lanka. So go figure. Because when a monk gets a Buddhist name, in Sri Lanka anyway, because many monks have the same name, like Rahula or Ananda, or Gunaratna, there's many Gunaratnas also. They put the name of their village before their name. So like Bhante Ji, his full name is Henapola Gunaratna. It means he's born from the village of Henapola, which is nicknamed Tumpani. Anyway, so when I was getting ordained, I had been to the yoga school before that, and my yoga teacher gave me the name Rahula. So when I came to get ordained, he said, "We need a name for you." And I said, "Well, I got a name, Rahula." He said, "Rahula, great, yeah, Buddha's son, okay." So now we need to call you California Rahula. No. So then he thought, okay, yoga vachara, because he knew I had gone to India and he knew I was practicing yoga. So he came up with that. I didn't even really know about it. It had a nice ring to it, yoga vachara Rahula. I said, okay, I'll take it. And that's how it came about. But it, you know, seemed to fit. Oh. No books, sorry, I can't read that. No. Did the Buddha still have an ego or personality after he reached Nibbana? He didn't have an ego as such. An I consciousness, although he had memory of who he is and all this, and you know, but his mind was purified of any egoistic tendencies. But certain personality traits, not necessarily in the case of a Buddha, but for arahants, the disciples of the Buddha, or people who reach enlightenment, not a Buddhahood, but just reach, the fourth stage of enlightenment, full enlightenment. They still retain personalities. And there's many stories in the suttas. There was one arahant who, when he went begging, he used to jump from one rice paddy dike to another. And monks saw him and said, "Monks shouldn't be jumping around like that." And the Buddha said, "He can't help it. He was a monkey in his last life." So he brought those traits with him. So, therefore, you know, attaining enlightenment doesn't necessarily mean it's going to wipe out all your little certain idiosyncratic states. And there was another monk who was an arhant who had been a Brahmin, you know, before. And Brahmins are kind of hoity-toity and, you know, in India and think they're superior and purer than others, at least in those days. Because of the caste system. And so he used to call other monks menials, or, you know, kind of use little demeaning words, not necessarily you know, like harsh speech, perhaps. I don't know. But anyway, he used to use some words like that. And monks also complained to the Buddha, and he said, look, the guy was a Brahmin before, give him a break, you know, don't pay any attention to him. You know. So anyway, like that, there's little things that may still occur, but, you know, they're not like any serious faults, or not to the extent of, you know, perhaps breaking precepts, but that's why there's differences. And there's some suttas where there's 20 or more arhants. You know, on a full moon night, the Kosambi Sutta, or one of these suttas, it talks about all these great monks sitting out in the full moon. And each of them was known for a certain quality. One was known for having psychic powers. Ananda was known for having a great memory. Others were known for their friendliness or whatever. So like that, they retain some kind of, you know, they're not all just clones, sterilized clones, you know. They still retain some of their personality. But if you ask certain Mahayana Buddhists, they may give you a different answer, because they think arhants are not pure, and they still have some defilements, but that's a different philosophical outlook. At least if you read some of the suttas and so on. Will you describe how to strengthen the diaphragm for those of us with weak ones that are challenging to locate and engage? Well, any of those exercises that, you know, where you bend back, like that one actually that we did, you know, usually in the morning, that first, after you roll up on top of the head and you sit back up and you put the hands behind the feet and you lean back on the straight arms and lift your hips up. They told her, when you lift the hips up, push your stomach out, breathe in and push your stomach out. That is for strengthening the diaphragm. Anything that uses the abdominal breath will strengthen the diaphragm. So even just sitting in meditation and doing abdominal breathing for 5 or 10 minutes, you know, but strong, good diaphragm, you know, putting extra pressure on that downward movement and on the upward movement. You know, sucking the thing in, you know, it's exercising that muscle. That's the way you strengthen the diaphragm. And doing things like the Mukha Bhastrika. And then that other one I showed, that more advanced one I showed, you know, this afternoon. So like those kind of ones strengthen the abdomen. And maybe some of those like, and the diaphragm, and perhaps things like leg lifting and so on. But just doing that diaphragmic breathing and the three-part breathing over time will strengthen it, if you do it, you know, enough. Is there truth to the saying that you must first have a healthy ego before you can transcend it? Yes, I think there is truth to that. Because even people that have a kind of an inferiority complex, that's also an ego, but it's a negative ego. That means they're still clinging to their self, but it's a negative one. Oh, I can't do this. Oh, I'm this or that. And unfortunately, because of the upbringing in society, and then certain, you know, when kids are young, some people, even in their own families or others, saying, oh, you'll never be much, you'll never account to nothing, you're stupid. So unfortunately, a lot of kids have grown up with this kind of, and when they're young, they're very impressionable, you know. And so they may grow up with this kind of feeling that they're inferior, or in other cases. And so, you know, that is also not the you know, they might not have a big ego, like strong, like certain politicians or others, but, you know, it's still a kind of a negative one. Because to transcend, you have to give up even that. So, yes, that's why we identify with the Buddha. And the Buddha is a egoless personality. And to identify that we all have that Buddha nature. Yes, I can do it. Even though it may be difficult, everyone has that inherent, intrinsic capability for eventually, you know, overcoming those shortcomings, if they have the right environment, the right support, and the right conditions, they can. But it's very difficult to get those conditions in this day and age. But you know, it can be done. People do it, despite all the odds. There are many people that at least make some improvements in their life. What is the Buddha's teaching on how to stand up to evildoers? You stand up to them by doing good. Is there such thing as a just war? Don't ask a monk that. You know, these questions are difficult. You know, the world has become so complicated. And yes, we standing up to, you know, evildoers or people that are ignorant, we stand up with, but you have to do it with loving kindness and compassion. And but sometimes you need to get frank or stern with a person. But not to the extent of, let's say, breaking some precept. And you know, if somebody's doing something wrong, I mean, teachers and student-teacher relationships, a teacher may rebuke the student if they're doing something wrong, or even the student rebuke the teacher sometime. There's a story about Sariputta, who was the captain of the Dhamma, and there was a young Samanera. And so one day Sariputta's robe wasn't hanging down, a little lopsided, you know, and monks are supposed to wear the robe even all around the bottom. And Sariputta's robe, you know, wasn't exactly even. And the young Samanera pointed it out to Sariputta. I mean, you know, captain of the Dhamma, right? And Sariputta was humble enough to say, "Thank you. Yes, you're right." And corrected his robe. So, anyway. But the main thing, we counter evil with truth. And we counter hatred with love, we counter falsehood with truth, and counter ego with, you know, humility. I know there's a movement called Engage Buddhism that is sometimes Buddhists, because they're often seen as, you know, not wanting to get involved in issues and kind of like wallflowers or something. And so there's a movement called Engage Buddhism where they train people to go to protests, you know, like protesting some things, ecological protests, like perhaps that Indian thing that went on in the last few months or something, or back in the 70s and 80s, you know, protests where they lay down on the railroad tracks or, you know, do something else, and, you know, cops would come and maybe beat them or other people, but they would not get violent. And they went to special nonviolent training where they would take abuse. Even if people hit them, they wouldn't violently react. Now, if you want to do something like that, you know, you can. But, you know, don't think that as Buddhists and meditators that we have to get politically active and so on, but it's not a bad thing. So you should vote. You know? If you want to change something, then go out and vote. And if you want to go on a protest, that's perfectly okay, but just try not to allow that to provoke your anger and then, you know, get into a fight and this and that. But if it happens, it happens. You have to take the consequence of your own behavior. So there's no absolute do's and don'ts. There's guidelines. If you do this, this may happen. You're the one that has to make the decision. But whatever you do, understand that it might have consequences. And if you're willing to accept that and not to blame anybody else, then that's up to you. What is this? Is no disrespect meant. Was it you who decided to drive to San Francisco, then smoke the joint, and ended up in Texas? No, not in this lifetime. Doesn't sound familiar. I might have smoked joints in other places, but not there. I was the one that smoked hashish in Europe and wound it up in prison in Afghanistan. That was my story. But I learned my lesson and was saved by the Dhamma, you might say. Is after you bow to the Buddha, what do you reflect looking at Buddha? I reflect on the profound wisdom that the Buddha had, because it's so profound. And when I first started meditating, doing a Vipassana retreat in Sri Lanka, I was still a layperson that time, that was in 1974. I was at Kandabodha Vipassana Center in Kandabodha. And they had little cubicles around a block, a building. And at the end of that building was a nice little shrine room with a nice little Buddha and some flowers and stuff. And I was just pretty new to the Dhamma at that time. I'd taken a Tibetan meditation course up in Nepal. And so for about almost a year, I'd been kind of, you know, meditating, been, you know, called like a Dharma bum, right? And then finally I took this first Vipassana course. Actually, not the first one, but anyway, I was at Kandabodha. And we had to do slow walking meditation around this block of kutis. And at the end, we'd pass by this shrine room. And at that time, I was getting a lot of very strong and powerful insights, and I was really, really inspired by, the practice. And I'd go in there and just stare at the Buddha and cried, but not sadness, cried with joy that I found this Dhamma, and that somebody like the Buddha had such wisdom that could teach this kind of, you know, Vipassana practice. You know, and a lot of tears came out, but it was tears of joy and just admiring, and, you know, because the Buddha image is so, I mean, if it's a good Buddha image, even this one, a nice image too. If you look at the face, it just exudes wisdom. It's like, that guy knows something, you know? And if you meditate and you start to get to a glimpse of your own mind, then, you know, that's what the Buddha had 100 times more, and that he could actually effectively teach it to people. So anyway, that's... kind of, I reflect on that and then aspire to try to be like that. I have heard that Vipassana practitioners can have supramundane jhanas. Can you explain what those are and how they are different from jhanas that samadhi practitioners experience? A supramundane jhana is for one who has attained the first stage of enlightenment. So people who don't have the first stage of enlightenment, that means entering the stream or higher, they attain mundane jhana. So that's the hallmark or the differentiation between what is mundane and supramundane. If something is called a supramundane, it entails being a sotapanna or having that magga jnana, magga and pala of the sotapanna and above, the other three stages. That's why not the ordinary vipassana practitioner. They might have vipassana jhana, that's not necessarily supramundane jhana. But the vipassana jhana, if you hold it enough, and you're following this system of the seven factors of enlightenment, then you can attain the supramundane jhana. But that's due to the insight. The supramundane means the insight. That's the quality. It means the insight coupled with the concentration makes it supramundane. That means beyond the ego. The ego is, beyond the ego consciousness. So that's basically when you see that we're in also the supramundane Noble Eightfold Path. That's only for somebody who's reached sotapanna and higher. They're on the supramundane Eightfold Path now. Anybody else who's not a sotapanna is practicing mundane Noble Eightfold Path. The supramundane qualifies it. That distinction is having attained at least that first stage of sotapanna. And then all the stages above that. Anyway, sometimes a lot of these terms are a little bit difficult to understand, and only once you get some inkling of when the mind really starts getting deep tranquility and, seeing how the ego fades away and so on, only then do you really start to understand what is the mind and so on. Will you explain the five-part bow the monks do? Is it a practice? Well, people bow in different ways, but normally Theravada monks, they do what is called a five-point prostration. It means their feet are touching the ground, then they bow forward, they put their hands on the floor, and they put their head on the floor between the hands. Some do it a little bit differently. Some keep their arms wide apart. Some keep them. But anyway, basically, it means having those five points of the body touch the ground, and then they sit up, and then they do it again. So usually they do it sitting on the haunches, like you've probably seen me. That the haunches mean you're up on your toes. That's painful for a lot of people. So some people can't do that because it's painful. And sometimes a hand position is different. But the one that I personally like is that when you bow, you touch the hand to the head, meaning may I purify my mind. Over the mouth, purify the speech. And touch the chest, purify the body. And then bow one time for the Buddha. And you come back up, then do it again like this, and then one time for the Dhamma, and then one time for the Sangha. But not all people do it that way. I learned that from the Tibetans. Because I took a Tibetan meditation course, there's some good aspects of that too that I learned. So I kind of, you know, incorporate and mix up a few different things, some of the things that I feel personally for myself has a good meaning. So, but you'll see that other people do it in different ways. And it, basically it's what you yourself make it, you know, what's in your mind, what kind of thoughts are in your mind, and how is, you know, how it's affecting you. It's not as any exact, you have to do it exactly in this kind of way. And that also goes with how you hold your hands, whether you keep your hands like this, whether you keep your hands like this, if you keep your eyes open or if you keep your eyes closed, or you know, you sit cross-legged or you sit in some other way. All the criterion would be, all the criterion should be is, how am I doing this? Is it helping me to have better mindfulness? Is it helping me to have better concentration? Is it helping me to develop wisdom? Is it helping me to, you know, basically practice? And if you see it is, then it's okay. But if you're doing things a certain way, of course you never know unless you experiment a little bit. You won't know if something may be a little different or better than another way. So it is good to experiment in a few different ways. Even for people, whether they want to focus their attention at the tip of the nose, or they want to focus their attention on the rising and falling in the abdomen, or they want to practice three-part breathing, or all these things. It's, how does it help you to gain better concentration, awareness, and wisdom? That should always be the guide, what's called the mirror of Dhamma. Short ones first. In yoga, breathing out is done starting from the lower lobe. You advise same thing in meditation. Only at the beginning of meditation when you're doing the three-part breathing. But that three-part breathing shouldn't be done all the time. Especially when you start to get more tranquil, you'll feel like letting go of the breath, because it becomes a hindrance to get into the deeper levels of detachment and tranquility. So that's why I've always, you know, said and recommended, you know, do it for the first some rounds, do it for a while until you feel relaxed, and then let go of it. So when you're doing the three-part breathing, yeah, you start here and to feel that gradual expansion and to get the benefit of that, that relaxation that, and so on, of those relating kind of movements. But then at a certain point, let go of it. Let the breath go back to its uncontrolled nature, and the breath maybe get very faint. Because see, when you're sitting still and you're not thinking too much, you don't need much oxygen. The body is a self-regulating organism. When it needs oxygen, it breathes. When it doesn't need oxygen, the breath will go down or get very shallow. And so when you're sitting still and not moving, the body doesn't need much oxygen. And thinking uses lots of oxygen. So if you have a lot of monkey mind and worries and agitation, then your breath is going to, you know, be kind of erratic. And but when your thoughts die down and you don't have many thoughts and the body is still, the need for oxygen becomes very little. Sometimes the breath may stop even for 30 seconds or a minute even. But the body needs more breath, it breathes in. And in some of the deeper states, like I think it's the fourth jhana or something like that, it's said that the breath will cease altogether, or it seemed to cease anyway, the physical manifestation of the breathing. But you breathe in through your skin pores too. Breath, the body will suck air in through the skin if it needs to. That's just very small amounts. So don't be afraid if the breath slows down or seems to stop. Because if it does, actually, that should be a very deep state of awareness. The pause after the out-breath, to increase that pause actually is a very deep state of tranquility. You can't really think in that pause. Even while holding in the breath or when the breath is out, you can't do much thinking. So that's why it's also a good technique for slowing down that momentum of thoughts and so on. But, when you're just doing going deeper into concentration, don't, worry about controlling the breath at all. Just, be aware of it, and if it stops, so don't be afraid of that. It'll start again when it's ready. And actually, in concentration practice, when you get the nimitta, when the breath gets really, really faint and almost seems to stop, when those hindrances are suppressed, then you might see a little pinprick of light in the mind, like the morning star or something like the sun rising in your mind. And that is said to be the substitute for the breath, and you focus on that. But if you don't get that, don't worry about it. If the breath stops, feel the contact of the body to the ground. So the touch points. So if you no longer really feel the breathing, just be aware of the buttocks pressing the ground, the feet pressing the floor, or the hands touching, any of those contact points, just to maintain awareness, that connection to the present moment awareness. Don't allow the mind to slip into some limbo or some sort of a blank state. This question is about the place where I studied yoga, so I think I answered that already by putting the name of the yoga ashram on the bulletin board in there. You can Google it and find out what's going on there. I've lost contact really with them. I don't pay much attention. I haven't been there since after the tsunami. I went one time. That was the last time I went there, in 2005, I think. But it's still going on, but it's not the same. In the heyday of the 70s, that was one of the premier yoga practicing places for the hippies and Dhamma bums. But the yogi was very strict there, and he used to throw anybody out who smoked or did any other bad behaviors. But it was known as a very tough kind of ashram, but very strong practice and so on. But then it kind of but it never got popular in the West. For some reason it never got really popular in the West. In Germany there are some teachers of that Swami, but in the States not too many. Just in time. It's 9:00. So, I may not have answered all the questions, but, sorry. We don't have time for all of them. And some of them I didn't want to answer. They might have been personal questions or ones that didn't pertain to our practice. So I left those out. Forgive me if I didn't answer your question. And just a note about tomorrow. There had been some little confusion over about tomorrow morning schedule and so on, but whether the whole thing was going to end at 9:30 or to have yoga and so on. So this is basically the definitive schedule for tomorrow morning. Okay, so it's the same. We have yoga at 5:15, meditation at 6, have breakfast at the same time. And this is the one thing I'm not sure we'll make an announcement at breakfast, either at 9 or 9:30. We might delay the meeting back here until 9:30 to give you more time to pack up your things, clean your room and so on. I think that's and then meet here about 9:30 for the closing talk. Okay? There'll be a closing talk. And then also giving you the 5 precepts, releasing you from the 8 precepts when you're going home. And then lunch about the same time normally. Okay? Does anybody have any questions about that? Yes?
The schedule as it's written says that there will be a Dhamma talk and meditation from 9:30 to 11. Is it just the talk?
Well, there may not be enough time for the meditation. Or you can come earlier and meditate. We might meditate for a while, but it won't be a long one. Because, the closing talk and all these other things is going to take up almost an hour and a half. No, lunches will be served after the... Yeah, lunch is included. I don't know where that... There's some confusion. I don't know what happened. Some missing wire or something that got left off. But